Now listen, I'm not a superstitious person. I really am not. I can walk under a ladder, I'll be fine. You know, the 13th floor on an elevator doesn't bother me a bit. I'm not superstitious. But how many of you know, this is a major period of time where superstitions and all the kooky stuff that goes along with this holiday we call Halloween. I'm not a real fan, personally. I'm not a real fan. But I will tell you that I believe God will give us discernment to discern the spirits that are loosed at a time like this under the guise of fun. We buy into a program, and don't let your kids go trick-or-treat. I'm not telling you that. I'm not telling you any of that stuff. That's between you and your kids and how you feel you need to walk it out. But I'll tell you, we buy into the idea of the spiritual aspect of Halloween sometimes more than we do the Spirit of God. We celebrate that more than we do Him. And I just go, what? What have we come to? But I'm not a superstitious guy. But every once in a while, I hear certain words, and they go over and over and over, and they pop up in a podcast, they pop up in a message. A word pops up in a song that we sing. It pops up in maybe our prayer focus that my wife and son have been taking our staff through. I mean, this word, it just keeps coming up. So I'm not superstitious. But when things like that happen, I have to tell you, I get a little suspicious and a little bit curious that God might be up to something. I'm not superstitious about it, but I am kind of curious. And that's why today I'm going to talk a little bit about glory. Everybody say glory.
Glory.
Come on, glory. His manifest glory, the glory, His glory, expect His glory, walking in glory. Man, this stuff's been coming at me for the last several weeks, all about glory. And finally, I got curious, maybe a little suspicious. And I thought, maybe God wants me to talk about glory. Sometimes hard to get through to me. What is glory? What is the Bible definition of glory? Well, you'll find it all through the Old Testament, and it's a Hebrew word. It's an interesting word, and it's pronounced kavod, kavod. It's actually spelled with a B, but it's pronounced with a V, kavod. And it literally means goodness. It means weighty. It means substance. It means excellence. It means all of these. It means magnificence. It means honor. It carries all of these meanings. And when God revealed Himself to Moses, He allowed His glory to be seen. And literally, when His glory was seen, it was saying, Moses got to see what God was made of. Because that's what it means. It's a weightiness. There's this weightiness to that word, glory. His manifest presence. When His glory comes in the room, His manifest presence comes in the room. His fullness, His goodness. Some people will say, yeah, but you don't have to wait for His presence to come into the room. But let me just kind of straighten it out a little bit. Let me tell you what this means. There is an abiding presence that Hebrews talks about. I believe it's in Hebrews chapter 13. It says, He will never leave you or forsake you. You know, the Bible tells us where any two gather together in His name, He's there in our midst. So there is an abiding presence of God in our lives. When you name the name of Jesus, He is present in that moment. Aren't you glad for that? There is an abiding presence, but there is a manifest presence. There's a manifest presence. See, I can come into a room like this and gather with people like you and a worship team like we have, and I can sing the songs, and maybe that's all you care about, just sing the songs. I'm not looking to sing songs. I love singing songs. Don't get me wrong. I love the songs we sang today. But I got to tell you, I'm not here to sing songs. I'm here to press into that manifest presence of God. I want to know His glory. I want to experience the fullness, the weightiness of who He is. I want to sense it. You say, well, we don't go by feelings. We walk by faith. Yeah, but I want to feel. There's nothing wrong with feelings. Just don't go by them. But I want to feel His presence. I want to know His weighty presence in the room. Man, I did today. Wow, man. Wow. When He walks in the room, everything changes. Everything. When His presence comes into a room, into a sanctuary, into our worship, into our prayer closet, into our automobile, it doesn't matter where you are. His manifest presence, His glory, His weightiness will come into that moment. If we're willing to pay the price, if we're willing to pay the price to experience that, you can't just speak words. You've got to press in and push through to that place where He is. You don't get it just by coming to church. I wish you could. I wish we could stir it up for you. But we can't. It's something you have to want. And it can't just be words. We see this in the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, 2 Chronicles, chapter 5, verse 14. Listen to this. This is under the Old Covenant. Listen to what happens. And they raise their voices and praise the Lord with these words. He is good, and His faithful love endures forever. Come on, let's say that. He is good, and His faithful love endures forever. Say it again. He is good, and His faithful love endures forever. Come on, say it real loud. He is good, and His faithful love endures forever. And just that. And it wasn't just because of the words. It was because how they had prepared themselves. The Bible says they had prepared themselves. They were dressed in white. That's a purity. They had prepared themselves. And it says at that moment, a thick cloud filled the temple of the Lord. And listen to what happened. The priest could no longer stand up to minister because the glorious presence of the Lord filled the temple of the Lord. I believe there is a manifest weightiness presence of God that He wants to bring into this place. That you better just let everything else go. You better let everything else go. Because He, listen, you say, well, I don't dance. I was brought up Baptist. Yeah, same with me. Praise the Lord. But that weighty presence may just kind of grab you, and He says, I want you to dance before Me with all your might. You say, yeah, but I don't do that. Yeah, but do you want to experience what you say you're going after? Do you really want it? I'm not telling you. Don't come on. Let your air out. Let your air out. Breathe. Come on, breathe. I didn't say you have to dance. But what will He tell you to do that you say, I don't know if I want to do that? I want muscles and a buff, fit body. I just don't want to have to go to the gym to get it. Can I take a pill? Just, I'm good at that. I'm really good at that. Well, actually, you can, but I don't want to go there. His weighty presence, the glory of God, filled the room where the priests were. I've been in situations like that. I was in that place this morning. I came so expecting to experience His presence today. They could have sung This Old Man. Knick-knack on my thumb or whatever that is. I don't know, on my knee or whatever. They could have sung anything. I'm kidding. Man, I was ready. I was on go. As soon as music started, I was on go. I couldn't wait for His presence to come in the room. Anybody else feel that? Anybody else experience that today? Huh? You say, well, I didn't. Well, then there's next week. And there's tomorrow. And there's on the way home in the car. I'm telling you, you can experience that any time you want. Come on, amen? There's a scripture in Psalm 126. I love this. I love this. I was watching an old video from 1996. I'm telling you right now, that those of you that have a problem with certain ministries, you know, sometimes we really avoid mentioning them because people have, you know, they hear things and, you know, but Kenneth Hagin used to have these winter Bible seminars. They still do have a winter Bible seminar, but Dad Hagin has gone to be with heaven to heaven several years ago. But in February 20th, 1996, pull it up on YouTube. It is about a 2.5-hour service where the Spirit of God moved. I mean, people laughed, people danced, people ran around the room, people couldn't talk, people were glued to the floor. There was a lady, I was watching it again last night, there was a lady, she was up in the choir area where they had to seat people because there were like 5,000, 6,000 people in the room, and they were just seating people everywhere they could. I was down in what was called the, it was kind of like the band thing, and it would lift up, and I was sitting over there. I had no idea this lady was doing this, but all of a sudden, she's up worshiping, and she's like this, and she was frozen like that for like an hour. I mean, through the whole service. Listen, you don't make that stuff up. Nobody wants to make that stuff up, because that's weird. That's really weird. But the presence of God was on her so strong. You know, what are we going to do? I've been in those kind of meetings where it's just, I mean, it's just off the hook. People running around, dancing, shouting, having a great time. The presence, the weighty presence of God just kind of keeps sweeping through the room. People are falling over. People are laughing. People are running. People are doing all kinds of stuff. And I'm telling you, man, it was a Holy Ghost wild thing. But I've also been in that same room. I don't remember the year. I think it was 2006 or 7, maybe 9. I don't remember. It doesn't matter. I was in that room, and we came to the end of a service, and I was down about the third row near the center aisle, and you know, the message was good. It was good. Learned a lot. There was no ministry to people. Nobody got prayed for. It was just a good message, and now we're going home. And the person that got up to close the service, he got up, and a guy was playing very softly on the piano behind, just very, very nice. It sounded beautiful. And the guy got up to close, and he stood behind the podium, and he's supposed to close, send us home. Come on, we want to go to the restaurant. We want to go hang out. We want to go see our friends. Nobody was really saying that, but that's what's supposed to happen. And he got up there, and he just stood there. And the person that was doing, I won't mention any names, but this person that was doing that, he is not a guy that just stands there. He's super talkative. He'll just jump in and say whatever at any time. He's a great man of God, wonderful man. But his personality is to get up and just, you know, start talking. He didn't. He just stood there with his eyes closed. And he stood there. He stood there. And a miracle of God took place. The weighty heaviness of the presence of God came into that room. The glory of God came into that room. Nobody moved. 5,000 people. Nobody moved. Nobody shouted. Nobody gave a nervous tongue and interpretation because, you know, you got to fill the space with something. I'm not against tongues and interpretations, but nobody did that. In that kind of a setting, that's normally what would have happened. Somebody would fill the space with something. Somebody would start shouting. Somebody would do something. And then all of a sudden, man, the weightiness became so heavy. I got down on my knees in that room. I didn't look around. I didn't know what anybody was doing, but man, I've got to hit my knees. I got down on my knees, and I just stayed there. Still nobody, and it's like 10 minutes later, it's 15 minutes later. When you got 5,000 people in a room and there's not a peep, there's not a baby crying, there's not a kid moving around, nobody's moving. The holiness of God, the awesome. You just could feel it. You didn't want to interrupt it. And at one point, I decided to look, what's going on in this room? Nobody was on their feet. 5,000 people on their knees. Nobody moving. Nobody wanted to violate that moment. He wants us to want that. He wants us to want that. He wants us to know His presence, to know His glory, to experience it. He wants us to know the weightiness of His presence. But there's a price to pay. There's a price to pay for that kind of presence. In Psalm 126, as I was going to read a while ago, it says, it was like a dream come true when you freed us from our bondage and brought us back to Zion. We laughed and laughed and overflowed with gladness. We were left shouting for joy and singing your praise. All the nations saw it and joined in, saying, the Lord has done great miracles for them. Do you hear that? Do you hear the result? That when the weightiness of God, the goodness of God shows up, when He delivers you from bondage like this morning, do you realize that the world notices when Christians walk free? They notice. It's like, I remember him. He was a mess and he's not anymore. What's on his life? Oh, surely the Lord has done great things for him. Surely it's got to be God. He's that guy that's always saying he goes to church. Wow, look at him. Look at him. The Lord has done great miracles for them. Yes, he did mighty miracles, and we are overjoyed. Now, Lord, listen to this. Now, Lord, do it again. Come on, say, come on, Lord, do it again. Say, do it again. Say, do it again. Do it again. Do it again. God, I want you to do it again. God, do it again. Do it again. Move in this church like you have in the past and even beyond what we've ever seen before. Move in this church. I know it's what you want. I know that's what you want to do. I'm convinced that you desire a move that will just set us free and we take our freedom to the world. I know that's what you want, God. Lord, do it again. Restore us to our former glory. May streams of your refreshing flow over us until our hearts are drenched again. Those who sow in tears as seeds will reap a harvest with joyful shouts of joy. They may weep as they go out carrying their seed to sow, but they will return with joyful laughter and shouting and gladness as they bring back armloads of blessing and a harvest that is overflowing. I never understood that thing about he who sows in tears will reap in joy. But if you think about somebody that's got a family and all they've got is a little bit of seed left, and instead of feeding their family, they go and they sow the seed. That's what it's talking about. It's talking about sowing seed that you could provide one more meal for your hungry family, but I'm going to sow this seed knowing that there is a great harvest that's going to come, that's going to take care of my family. And they would sow in tears. Oh, I know that could feed them. I know what this would do for them. But I got to think about the future. I got to think about where we're going. I got to think about tomorrow and the other tomorrows. And they would sow that seed in tears. But when they did, they knew there would become a day of laughter, of shouting, of joy, of gladness. They would bring armloads of blessing. The harvest has come in. So what are we doing? I got to close. I need to be done. Boy, I'm not done. My wife, as she is quite the devourer of books, she reads and reads and reads. She's reading a book by a guy named Jeremy Riddle. He was, for a number of years, worship leader at Bethel out in California. Now he's in Southern California. But he wrote this book called The Reset. Sounds like a great book. I haven't read it yet. I'm waiting until they make a movie. She pays the price. She tells me what it says. No, that's not good. That's not good. Strike what I just said. The jury will strike that last comment. But the byline of this book is this. The byline says this: returning to the heart of worship, listen, and a life of undivided devotion. Undivided devotion. Listen to what he says. Page 86, it's a paragraph that she had typed out, and I put it in this message. Listen to this paragraph on page 86 for anybody that gets the book. He says, I find myself dreaming of an atmosphere of worship so full of his glory that it transforms anyone coming into it. I see people coming in with callous, deadened hearts toward God, but leaving fully alive to him. I see people coming in oppressed and harassed, but leaving fully liberated. A people coming in asleep to the call of God on their lives, but leaving awakened to their divine destiny. A people coming in under the weight of depression and despair, but leaving in great joy and gladness. A people coming in bound by addiction and disease, but leaving unshackled and free. A people coming in afflicted by bodily pain and suffering, but leaving healed and restored. I want that at Grace. I want that. That is our heart. That describes our heart. That's what I want for you. That's what I want for the people of this world, the people that God is bringing into this church. I want that. I want that. Remember the byline. He said, returning to the heart of worship and a life of undivided devotion. There's a war that is raging. And let me close with this thought. There's a war that has been raging for the last several years. And so many of us have gotten caught up on the wrong side of this battle. This war that has been raging, it's intensified over the last 4 or 5 years especially. It's been a political war. It's been a racial war. It's been about social media. It's been about pandemic. It's about gender. It's about inclusion. It's about all these things. And every one of those things have things that we should talk about. Every one of those things have a place. But what has happened? Here's what has happened. It's a war of our attention. Remember the byline. Remember the byline. A life returning to a heart of worship and a life of undivided devotion. It's a war for our attention because the enemy wants to divert our affection and divide or dilute our devotion. You can only be devoted to so many things in life. You can't be, in a healthy way, devoted to all these issues that we've been fighting about that have torn churches apart, that has torn this church apart. Sad to say, breaks my heart. Breaks my heart. That somebody would come in with a mask on and receive criticism from somebody that has bought into the other side of that argument and they've never come back. That breaks my heart because there's freedom here. There's freedom here. Somebody would come in pierced and tattooed or wearing a hat and they'd be told, you can't wear a hat in the building. You can't, you know, tattoos are of the devil. Leviticus tells us, you know, don't mark. Well, as long as you're not dancing naked around a fire, cutting yourself and marking yourself, serving a demon god, I think you're okay. Read the context. Also tells you don't cut your hair. Just saying. I'm not trying to cause trouble for you parents, but don't try and make it a Bible thing. Make it a parent thing. And that's okay. You can make it a parent thing, but don't make it a God thing. Come on. Amen? It's a war for our attention because the enemy wants to divert our affection and dilute our devotion. We've got a little ways to go, but I love where we're headed. Can you say amen to that? Say, I love where we're headed. Come on, say it. Now say it with conviction.